third world foreign exchange. Right. Seth Gaines.
Trini.
Boy, where I'm from, the slums is beautiful. Dirt roads, potholes, bare back suitable. Paid in by the standpipes, galvanized roof, yo. So if you don't give a fuck, the feeling is mutual. Musical, magical.
I'm just so excited about what you're doing, in the context of your business and also in the context of your culture. And so I really felt like it would be a really great conversation for you and I to have, because I really want folks in the Black Travelers Network community to know a lot more about you and, you know, your background, and definitely encourage people to support Third World Famous. And so before I kind of just start asking you questions, I'd like to first introduce myself. I'm Jessica Johnson. I'm the founder of Black Travelers Network. Most people on my platform know me. And you, my friend Brahma, can you please introduce yourself to everyone?
Hi, greetings everybody. My name is Jerome Brahma. Everybody just calls me Brahma. I'm originally from Trinidad and Tobago, most southerly isles in the Caribbean. I now reside in the United States, Washington, D.C. to be exact. I have a clothing brand called Third World Famous. As the name suggests, you know, it's a brand that represents things that are well-known or famous in third world culture, but not so well-known or not known at all outside, like in countries like U.S., Canada, England, and the rest of Europe. And if you think about it, countries from like Jamaica to Mexico to Colombia to Ethiopia to Philippines all have certain things in common, from even if it's just geography to climate to past shared colonial histories to having indigenous African peoples as their first peoples in those countries. A lot of similarities, politics, you know, and I just trying to connect the dots between those cultures, right? And also because I live in the States and I'm able to do that because of the struggle that Black Americans have gone through here in the United States, I also try to make the connection between third world culture and Black Americans. And so, for example, I'm from Trinidad, so, you know, Stokely Carmichael, also known as Kwame Ture, he was originally from Trinidad. He left Trinidad when he was about 11 or 12 years old, migrated to the United States, New York City to be exact. And he went on to be instrumental in the civil rights era, right? He's the man who coined the phrase Black Power. And yet many Americans don't know that he's Trini. Many Trinis don't know that he's Trini. So, you know, yeah, I mean, it's not something that they teach us in school, Jessica, right? You know, they're not going to, even though Trinidad is a Black nation, and I think this is an important point, you know, to our fellow brothers and sisters in Black America, just because we live in Black countries doesn't mean it's sweet for us either. Because go ahead.
I think that's really important to point out and highlight, because this is exactly why I always talk to our folks about travel. And we really focus in on traveling and making that cultural connection that goes beyond the United States. So definitely say more about that.
Yeah, I was going to say, so, you know, yes, we may live in quote unquote Black nations in the Caribbean, Central America, South America, Africa, obviously. But sometimes the people who do the wickedness to you are the people who look like you. So I understand in the United States, Black Americans feel the pressure because the wickedness is done by somebody outside of their race. But when it's somebody within your own race, sometimes it's hard to see, or hard to see it for what it really is. You just think it's something else, but it's the same thing being done to you. So it's a different dynamic, but kind of the same in a way. And I think it, you know, to the point about Stokely, you know, the Black governments in the Caribbean, they don't want to teach their citizens about Black Revolution, because the Black governments in the Caribbean, they maintain the status quo. And a lot of times the status quo is remnants of colonial past. So the people, the elites in the government, they have the power and the wealth because they were the token people who the past colonizers chose and handpicked to be part of the system. And then even the ones who join in the system later, they don't have enough power to change the system. So what you see is that, you know, Trinidad had a Black Power revolution in the 70s, right? Right after the civil rights era in America. They didn't teach me. I was born in 1980. They never taught me that in school. I mean, they didn't teach me about it in school. I heard about it from my parents casually, but it's not like it was at the tip of everybody's tongue and they're like, okay, you know, we have to carry on the fight. No, the exact opposite.
So tell us, okay, when did you come to the United States and what can you kind of talk a little bit about when you came and what your experience has been like here versus being in Trinidad? Because I know we have a number of travelers who probably may only be familiar with Trinidad from a carnival kind of lens, or from spending maybe like a couple days there at the most, but most of the time, carnival really attracts a lot of folks from the U.S. to Trinidad. So can you say more about those experiences and what people may not know about it?
Okay, so I came to the States in about, I think it was 2002 for school. And I went to Howard University. I went to Howard in Washington, D.C., you know, one of the most popular HBCUs in America, right? Uh-huh. And we were talking about Stokely. Stokely went to Howard.
That's right.
So, just to give you a little background with the process, you know, so students, obviously, you know, they have to apply for student visas, right? And usually you don't have a problem getting a student visa once you have been accepted to a university. You know, what they want to see is how can you pay for school? Can you come, are you coming on a scholarship, partial scholarship? Are you paying full fees? That's more what the government, they want to know that you're going to come in and be able to complete the thing that you said you're coming to do, right? So from a student visa point of view, it isn't as hard as long as you can meet those two or three requirements. Now, for other people who are traveling to the United States, it's not as easy, right? Now, if you're coming to say just as a visitor, they want to make sure that you're going back to your country at some point.
That's
right. They don't want you to overstay. So they want to see that you have a steady job in your home country. Some ties, you know, if you have a house or if you have children or something that's going to make you go back to your home country. Those are things that help your visa application go through a little bit easier. You know, if you can't show steady income and a job to go back to, if you can't say I have kids that I won't abandon or a house that I'm not willing to give up, then it's not that it's impossible. It's that much harder, though. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a visa application might be $1,000. That's a lot of money for people who live in Trinidad or in other parts of the Caribbean. Right. You know,
Other parts
of the world, right? Because you're not guaranteed to get it, right?
That's right.
It's a privilege if they're giving it to you. So you can spend $1,000, which can be like a month and a half, 2 months salary, 3 months salary for some people back home, and then still be denied. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so the process isn't always the easiest thing.
I don't think a lot of people understand that does not include the fees that some people incur when they have to travel from different parts of the country to even get to the place where they have to apply.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's a good point. So like in Trinidad, I mean, Trinidad is an island, you know, it's not one of the biggest islands in the Caribbean either. So, but there's only one U.S. embassy. And of course it's in the capital, right? So if you live in Trinidad's other big city, San Fernando, that's about 2 hours drive. And then you got to come early. And there's like growing up, everybody knows that you drive around the Savannah where the U.S. Embassy is, and you can see the line wrapping around the building.
Wow.
For people applying to get visas to go to the United States. So you get early, you get there early, you might have to travel from far, then you still have to line up in a long line. And you better make sure all your paperwork is filled out correctly. You better make sure you have the right amount of money. And then you get in there and you're still not guaranteed anything. So yeah, you know, in other bigger countries, for sure, they might have to travel just to get up longer distances. And those are things that you have to consider. And so, you know, I think it's important to point out, because I know that in the United States, a lot of people don't necessarily travel that much, Jessica, right? You know, United States is big enough where, like, you can experience, if you just travel the United States, you can experience a whole lot, right? So
yeah,
there's a certain, I would say, the educated and the people who can afford to travel are the ones who have passports in the United States. I think that's a fair statement, right? I feel like it's the wanting to have a passport is growing within the Black community. I do feel that. But at the same time, it's not probably where it should be, right? And, you know, on the flip side, as much as we have to jump through all these hoops from the Caribbean to get to the United States, I can't think of one Caribbean country that Americans need a visa to come to. So, you know, the economics of it, of course, we want American dollars. So we want to make it as easy as possible for Americans to come to the Caribbean and different countries and just spend their money. The only third world country that I can think of is Brazil, that require Americans to have a visa, right, to visit
America. Well, that's a newer change as of 2019. They abolished that. It happened during the Trump administration. But, you know, you're right in that prior to that, for the most part, with the exception of the Olympics, most Americans needed a visa to get into Brazil. But that's no longer the case.
So you can see the power dynamic between United States and many other countries, right? Of course, America requires everybody, with the exception of, like, Europeans, right? Canada and everybody else got to get a visa, right? And, you know, so the America is saying, well, you want to come to us, you know, we don't want to go to you that much, or, you know, we need to be able to track you, so you got to have a visa and all this stuff to come. You know, it's also about money. Right, the U.S. Embassy, they get those applications, those $1,000 every time. That's money, you know. And, you know, we, a lot of the times in less developed nations, if you will, right, we don't have the leverage to kind of ask for certain things, right? You know, we get military aid and funding a lot of the times from the United States and some of the bigger countries. And all they do is threaten to take that away from you anytime you kick up a fuss. So,
absolutely.
You know, until we kind of like get united and say, you know what, America, guess what? All these Caribbean countries decided together, you all need a visa to come here. Same way we need a visa. Until something like that happens, I don't see any change. No?
Yeah, because the money that people have to pay, whether it's for visas or, you know, to enter the country, a lot of people never connect the dots, but those are funds that goes back into that country. And so I think that's an important thing to make sure that people are aware of, because it really is a whole economy behind, you know, people even being able to you know, apply to come and, you know, not even being accepted. And oftentimes people who don't get a chance to come the first time will apply a second time. It typically takes them a little bit longer, but people who apply and save up that money, these are folks who really want to come to the United States. With a quarrel, with a talking shit, they think you know, judge handing you down 3 to 6.